Welcome to another edition of Bucher and Friends, subsidiary of the United WeCast Network. My guest today is going to be Rick Brunson, former NBA player, former NBA assistant coach, last with the Minnesota Timberwolves. He resigned from the Timberwolves last spring, and while there hasn't been a whole lot said about that, he is not at liberty to disclose anything that resulted in his resignation for contractual reasons. So if you're wondering why we didn't talk about it or I didn't ask about it, that is why. Now, if you are enjoying this show Monday through Friday, Will Blackman being here on Mondays and Tuesdays, Ryan Hollins being here Thursdays and Fridays, follow the show on Twitter and Instagram at Bucher Friends. Please drop us a rating and review on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. Now, if you screenshot your review and tweet it to us at Bucher Friends, you'll be entered for a chance to win some swag from Ryan, Will, or myself. We also want to let you know that we've partnered with 99designs.com to help us with the new cover art for the podcast. There is a contest running right now for any graphic designers who want to submit concepts. You can find the link on our Twitter account, at Bucher Friends. Submissions end on November 1st. And now, here's my conversation with Rick. Happy to be joined by Rick Brunson, former NBA player. We did a story back in the day about the road that he took. How many one-year non-guaranteed contracts did you have, Rick?
Out of my 9 years, I did 8 in a row.
Yeah, that's what I thought. 9 years in the league, has been an assistant coach for the Bulls, the Bobcats, the Timberwolves, and is now sitting back and watching his son, second-round pick for the Dallas Mavericks, champion at Villanova, Jalen Brunson. And we ran into each other the other day in Phoenix. I believe it was the opener for the Mavs and the Suns. You're now in the position of watching your son play and play in the league at the highest level that you scraped and fought to be able to play at. I start there just by saying, I have to imagine it's different when you're an assistant coach in the league and watching him play in college than now kind of sitting back, your dad in the stands, watching Jalen play. What is that like for you?
Man, it's nerve-wracking, you know. Like, I remember last year when I was coaching with Minnesota, there were times we're playing a game and I know he has a game at the same time and I'm trying to get the score. It's just like you're trying to concentrate on your job. You know, you want success for your children. And obviously, you know, me and him and work very hard to try to help him reach his dream and then sit back and watch it unfold. And, you know, it's fun. But like I tell people, he's won 2 national championships. And I don't even think I got to enjoy it the way I really want to enjoy it, because it's like you're just nervous the whole time. You know, every game is just nerve wracking. As I look back now, it was a great ride in college. And now hopefully you can have a great ride in the NBA.
Jalen strikes me as an anomaly, because I look across the board at the athleticism, the length, the size. I mean, Ryan Hollins, who I do the podcast with on Thursdays and Fridays, says aliens. Yeah, and every team has to have an alien, which is really a step above what we're seeing. And Jalen is, to me, and I don't want to underplay his athleticism, yep, but he is really doing it through his understanding of the game, his fundamentals. And I think he's giving hope for all those people that aren't born 6'9 with a 40-inch vert and a 7-foot wingspan, that they too can play at a very high level.
Well, what I say to that, because I've actually played in the NBA, and I always hear people talk about athleticism. You know, in the NBA, it's probably, you know, sometimes it's hard to take a great athlete and make him a basketball player. You know what I mean? So I'd rather have a great basketball player who's not an athlete. That's easy.
Interesting.
I don't want to call any names out, but we can go through the history of the game.
Yeah.
How many times have they tried, even in football, let's go get a track star, make him a wide receiver?
Yeah.
It never works. But, like, that's all they talk about, athleticism. Listen, man, in order to be NBA player, in order for him to even get drafted, he obviously had to have some type of skill. You know, in order for him to make the Dallas Mavericks, he had to have some type of NBA skill. And we get so caught up in that. And I can go through the whole draft, guys drafted before him. They were little and unathletic, and they were lottery picks.
Mm-hmm.
But no one talks about that.
Yeah.
You know, that bottom line is he can play, he's a proven winner. And he has to keep proving himself himself to the Dallas Mavericks organization, and that's it, and see what happens.
And I agree with you on all that, but I would dare say that you know from an NBA perspective, and I actually just did this, did a piece on Luka Doncic and Euro players and how there's a discount on them and what they do. What Doncic did over in Europe doesn't get full recognition because they question, does he have the athleticism to compete in the NBA? There's immediate downgrade. And I dare say that Jalen, if you look at what he accomplished, if you look at his track record, he suffered from the same thing. Like this idea that you have to fit a certain picture, the measurables, as they say, right?
Well, what we look for, right? This is the reality of the NBA. The reality of it is the people upstairs who behind closed doors, right? Who, you know, as they say, the numbers people, the analytics people who never show their face, they want to say, I found that gem. No one wants to say, yo, that guy's a good basketball player, draft him, because it's just easy. Just like Luka, he's unathletic, but he could play, and he's won for a long time. And look at him now. He's playing the right. He understands how to play basketball. If you can understand how to play basketball, in my opinion, you have a shot to be a very successful player at the highest level. Now, if you're athletic and you jump over the rim and you can play too, I mean, this just takes you to a higher notch. But, you know, there's 450 players. You can't tell me 450 players or 400 players are all athletic and they're great. It's a mixture. That's why God created all of us different. It's a mixture of different type of basketball players.
So you were an assistant coach with the Nuggets, the Bulls, the Bobcats, and the T-Wolves. Mm-hmm. I know how you came up and what you were able to accomplish. How, I don't know, challenging, frustrating. What was it like to deal with that mindset in a multitude of places? Because I dare say it was probably prevalent in all those places in terms of the players that you were being given to coach were maybe not the ideal model, considering that you played in the NBA and you knew what it took to be a player in the NBA.
Great question, right? So as coaches, we don't get to, me personally, I love basketball, so I would watch college as well as NBA. But like, let's say draft time, you got guys coming in working out, right? And I know my eyes tell me what it takes to play in this league. Now, I've been wrong. I've been right. And I remember a question, it was in Chicago, right, working for the Bulls. And they were like, well, who's the best players in you guys seen thus far before the draft, the guys that brought in? And the two answers that I gave, and I will say this, our staff gave, the assistants, was Isaiah Thomas and Jimmy Butler. And we were told those guys are second-round picks. I was like, oh, but they're good. They dominate the workouts. And look at them. I mean, both of them all-stars.
Yeah.
To me, you know, they came, and Jimmy worked his butt off to get to where he is today. I watched him work, you know. Yeah. I got a question for you.
Yeah.
Because I'm not even going to mention no names, but I've coached guys that have tremendous length and athleticism and couldn't guard you.
Yeah. Yeah. No.
And you watch guys like that.
And I've actually had a chance to play pickup with some guys. There were NBA guys. We'd play 3-on-3, and I'm not going to name names, but with the Warriors back in the day, and I was amazed, like a little pump fake, and the guy's flying by me, and I'm thinking, you're so long, like, how the hell did that work? Like, how am I getting by this guy? And so, I've experienced that firsthand, and I'm not trying to pretend that I'm a player of any note.
No,
in basketball.
I know, I do. I played in that league for 9 years, and I'm like, how can I go by this guy? This guy is super fast, super quick, but he doesn't think the game.
Yeah.
But again, I'm not here to discredit what, like I said, there's a variety of NBA players, and to me, my son was four, the history of college basketball, one of four players to ever win multiple championships and play the year. And you're talking about his athleticism.
Yeah.
Like, what about his? And then you get mad at guys, like, for example, in the NBA today. Oh, he doesn't care about winning. Well, you don't draft guys to win. You draft athleticism. So why should he care about winning? It just makes no sense to me. The guy's one of all-time winners in this college basketball players in the history of college. But yet, that doesn't matter because he doesn't fit your NBA painted picture of a player.
I wonder, too, if some of it is, as you said, that it's a matter of people want to look really smart, so they overthink it.
For sure.
So you don't want to take the guy who just won championships at Villanova because everybody's going to go, well, duh. You're not going to get any credit if he turns out to be great. I feel the same way about Mo Wagner in where he went. I looked at the way he played, same criticism about the athleticism. I just saw a guy who played hard and understands the game. And I'm thinking, I was a little surprised that he went as low as he did, because I thought he proved
a few things. When I saw that kid play, they couldn't tell me he wasn't allowed. I was like, the guy's 6'10", whatever he is, mm-hmm. and shoots to three. Right there. That takes you. That's what they want, right? And I'm like, if he was at Kentucky, if he's at Duke, if he's at these programs where, you know, like, I guess the NBA teams look up to, then he would have been a lot. The same thing with Jalen. He would have been a lottery pick. But you're at Villanova. You're at Michigan. Oh, okay, they're good schools. The guys, they're in the Final Four. Yeah. It's just, to me, you're as a parent, and I told Jalen, that's one thing about Jalen. I told him from day one. I said, we don't worry about, like, where you go. Because at the end of the day, in 2018, in 2028, you're going to look back and say, wow, that guy was a lottery pick, and he's out. He'd only played 3 years. Or he only played 2 years, or he's out. You know what I mean? Like, right. It don't matter how you start, it's where you finish.
With that in mind, what was it like watching on draft night and you see the draft unfold and he goes third in the second round?
Well, just so you understand, and I'm not making this up, and you can call him directly. He'll tell you exactly what happened. I told him, we talked to Dallas. I knew we were talking to Dallas, not me personally, but, you know, his agent, right? Mm-hmm. So I said, son, you're going to get picked 33 by Dallas, okay? This is the day of the draft. He, like, looked at me. I said, trust me, because if a team wanted you, they would have told us by now, right? Everyone was like, well, we like him, but we like this guy too. So I know the NBA, and Dallas was the only team that was like, yo, like, we want this guy. They thought about trading up for him. So I was like, yo, if you get to Dallas, that's where you're going.
With that in mind, we talked about Luka Doncic, talked about Jalen. They're both with the Dallas Mavericks. I don't think that's by accident. What is it about the Dallas Mavericks? What do you credit the Dallas Mavericks for having that they're willing to pick what looks to me like guys who are proven basketball players rather than just looking for proven athletes?
I mean, when they won the championship, they had basketball players. They didn't have just athletes. They had guys that could play basketball, understood the game. You know what I mean? And I think in their front office, they look for more basketball players. One thing I've heard about Mark Cuban, he likes pedigree. You know what I mean? So they go in, like, they go deeper into the soul of a basketball player. Jalen comes from a basketball family. Luka comes from a basketball family, and that goes a long way.
Interesting.
And I think the culture they're trying to build there, the type of player, the type of kid they want to bring in there, not just a great basketball player, but somebody that's going to be great, you know, with teammates, unselfish. And I think that's what they're trying to build, and that's what you see in the draft.
So you credit Mark Cuban for that?
Because
I was just wondering where it started.
Winning starts at the top, the owner. You can't win unless the owner wants to win. That's just the reality of it. You credit Mark Cuban. You credit what type of people you bring in there. And it's talking to my son. Like, he's like, Dad, like, these dudes, like Devin Harris and J.J. Barretta, that's like two more coaches that my son has.
Yeah.
They're not like, yo, F this little rookie, man, because, you know, it's my last go-around, and I want some. Now, they're coaching him, telling him what to do, encouraging him. Like, you know, that's how I was. I wasn't as good as those guys, but I was the other coach, you know, helping out Sean Livingston. So, to me, you got to credit, you know, Mark and their front office of what type of guys they're bringing in.
I'm amazed at the number of teams that don't recognize the value of the Devin Harrises and the J.J. Barreas and the veteran guys who you still have to be able to play. I don't believe that anybody in the locker room listens to you unless you can get it done a little bit, right?
Yeah.
If they're kicking your ass in practice, they don't want to hear about how you should be doing it this way. They're like, dude, right?
For sure.
But it amazes me that, again, and I think it's trying to look smart, fill it with a lot of young guys, hoping that one of them's going to hit, instead of having those guys. And I was in the Dallas locker room. I saw exactly what you're talking about. I always knew that about J.J. Barea. I was really impressed by Devin Harris. Devin Harris was literally, like, he was checking in. And I can't remember who it was that struggled in the game or whatever, but he was making a point of, we got to take care of so-and-so. We got to check in with so-and-so. We got to make sure everybody's on the right page. And kudos to him. And you know, over an 82-game season, that stuff is huge, as opposed to my teammate over here is trying to jack me around because he wants my minutes, or he wants me to fail, or he's fearful of his spot, and teams just don't succeed in doing that.
Well, you think about it. If you invest in a guy like JJ, and first of all, JJ can still play any team, and like you said, Devin, right? To me, guys like Dennis, guys like Luka, guys like Jalen, the young guys, if they see what a professional is, then guess what? Your culture still goes, keeps going. Same thing at Villanova. It hasn't stopped. It starts back way back when Jay Wright first got there, even before him with Rolly Massimo. It just, your culture keeps going. If you try to start all over as a franchise and bring in all young guys, guess what? Everyone's fighting for what? A check. They don't care about winning. Yo, I'm trying to get paid. I'm better than this guy. I'm better than this guy. I'm better than Dennis Smith. I should be playing over Dennis Smith. This is BS. You know, that's how it works. That's what I saw when I was a player. Like, when I was in the league, it was more mixture of old guys, young guys to kind of teach them how to be a professional.
Right. That's where I see a problem with the Lakers for that reason, in that you have young guys, a number of young guys who want to prove that they belong in this league. And then you have some older guys who still want to play, you know, maybe Rajon, but I don't think Michael Beasley's ready to play a mentor's role.
Exactly.
And I'm not down on Lance Stephenson, but I don't think that's his, you know, his role.
But you got to look, I coach Lance, and I think Lance is a great, very good player. But his career, he don't look at his career as going down. He looks at his career as going up. So I'm still trying to play and show that I can play because I want to keep making money.
Exactly.
And you can't blame him for that. It's his job.
But you can't put that mix together and expect that everybody's going to make the necessary sacrifices, especially Lance, Beasley, and Rajon on one-year deals. They have to have an eye toward, okay, they're preserving their cap room for a reason. It's not to keep me here, so I'm auditioning for the other 29 teams every time I play. I just that ultimately is going to be an issue that I don't know if they're going to get around. All right, you mentioned you coached Jimmy Butler in Chicago and in Minnesota. I did a story on him, where he came from, the extraordinary events that led to him going to Marquette, the only option he had, and how he made himself into a player in Chicago under Tibbs. And I'm just the Jimmy that's making decisions now, the Jimmy that is talking now, I see glimpses of that Jimmy. But I'm kind of baffled at how do I coincide the Jimmy and his story coming up and the Jimmy who is saying, I want out and I want to play for the Clippers, the Nets, the Knicks. That doesn't fit with the other Jimmy.
Okay. Well, I can talk about this. I watched this man go from the 30th pick to being an all-star. I will credit. And maybe Jimmy might disagree with me, but Adrian Griffin, great assistant coach, now he's with Toronto, right? Adrian Griffin's walked that man every day to being a great player. I'm talking about mentally, physically, just working him out, working his brain. So I do see what you're saying, all right? But in this day and age, right, Jimmy sees, okay, I'm 30-some years old. This is going to be my last go-around, right? And instead of Jimmy just saying, listen, I don't want to play for $100 million. I want to play for, I think it's $189 million. The problem with these young guys in the NBA, just say what it is. It may come off wrong, but what you're doing now makes it worse.
Yeah.
You know, because he's not that person. To me, I would say this, great teammate, unbelievable worker, right? He's right. You can go in there after go in the locker room and ask him what his teammates feel about him. Jimmy is unbelievable teammate, in my opinion, from what I saw the years that I worked with him.
In Chicago, too? Because the one thing
I have him when he was with Fred, so let's make that clear.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So I was there with Tibbs. So what happened in Chicago, I can't speak upon. I was not there.
Got you.
But I'm just talking about as a teammate. I'm talking about off the court, being a mentor, talking to guys, not being a jerk. That's the things that I saw.
Yeah.
I didn't see that in Jimmy. Okay. Now on the court, what I did notice about Jimmy, if you didn't work like him, me and Jimmy talked, you can ask him. We had this conversation. I said, Jimmy, because you work your butt off and the man next to you don't work, doesn't make him a bad person. Like, we all build differently. You can't put your values on another man. That's not fair to him. Because, oh, you don't work, you're not a good player. No. Just because he don't work, that has nothing to do with you. You gotta help him and teach him how to get to your level, which he won't, because you're elite. You're top 15.
Yeah.
You know, so I think Jimmy, the reality of all this, and just write about it. Yo, I want the Supermax deal, period. And the four teams I named have that money, period. Like, stop with all the other stuff.
Yeah.
Stop with Carl. Stop with Wiggs. I want to get paid because this is my last, you know, hurrah. And I'd rather get paid first and win second.
Yeah.
It's okay.
I feel as if LeBron has done the same thing. Like, he went to L.A. for a lot of reasons. Don't tell me you're in championship mode.
No. He won already.
Yeah. And it's okay. Look, you earned it. You earned to go where you want to go, live where you want to live, play with who you want to play with. There are very few guys who have the authority or the status to be able to do that. I don't fault him for any of that. My problem is when I'm hearing you're LA bound and I'm hearing it at the beginning of the year and it's got nothing to do with what happened last season. Your relationship with Dan Gilbert is fractured. That ain't going to change. And you've got all these projects and these ideas and mansion in Beverly Hills. You want to live in it. You want your sons to go to play hoop in LA and the LA area. I'm good with that.
Yeah, but don't just do it.
Don't like try to throw all. I want to bring the legacy back to the Lakers, and I want to win a champion. Like it's no. Everything you've done says, okay, that would be nice if it happened, but that's not your reason for going, and that's not your goal.
No, and you like you said, he earned that right. Like we all dogged him. Oh, you know, he can't win a champion. He's won now.
Yep.
Now just get your money, right?
Yeah.
Go to L.A., build your legacy or build whatever you're building outside of basketball.
Career,
get ready for your next life.
Yeah, the post-playing career. That. Yeah, 100%. 100% with that.
But the difference between LeBron is LeBron's and I don't think LeBron is being loud about things like Jimmy. And this is what Jimmy doesn't understand. Like, it hurts somebody like a Coach Thibodeau who is like, that's supposed to be his guy.
Yes. See, that's
the thing. That's your guy. And I don't think Jimmy, and I know Jimmy. Jimmy and Tibbs are tight, but I don't think Jimmy understands, like, it affects him.
Oh, in a huge way. I mean, I'm actually surprised that you say that they're tight because what he's done to Tibbs, I mean, Tibbs is, by some accounts, dead man walking in Minnesota. It's put him in an impossible situation. He brought Jimmy in. Like, he gave up talent. You look at that
for
deal
Jimmy
that Chicago
Butler.
Made.
And Jimmy don't even realize. I honestly believe, and I'm just my own personal, I think Jimmy sits back next summer and sees what happens to Tibbs, he will realize, oh, I made a mistake. I don't think he's not doing this malicious towards Tibbs at all. That's just my opinion.
Boy, is that a blind spot. Because, you know, from where I sit, there's no doubt. That was one of my biggest questions is, wow, because Tibbs, you could make a
case.
That's his guy. He gave Jimmy the opportunity to become Jimmy Butler in Chicago. He gave him the latitude, gave him the opportunity, and then makes a deal for you to bring you in because you are going to be the missing piece, and you go, nah, I don't want to be here. Oh, wow. That kills Tibbs.
I mean, like again, in my opinion, how you should have handled it, he should have went to Tibbs one-on-one after the season. Hey, Tibbs, listen, man, this is what I want. I want to get paid, okay? Yeah. And obviously, Minnesota doesn't have the money to pay me. Do me a favor, man. Find a trade for me. This them two. And I think if they did that, everything would have been, cool. But to do it the way he did it, I don't think Jimmy realized, the magnitude of what he was doing. I really don't. Because, man, I go to war with him because Jimmy, to me, is not a malicious person. Hmm. I didn't see that. So
I'm glad to hear that because that's not the guy that I...
No, I never saw that in Jimmy, man.
Yeah, I've been around him last year,
man,
too.
I work with a guy. I enjoy him. I never saw a malicious... I saw a giving guy, always. Hmm. He's just a giving person, man. Like, And other people might have different stories about him. Hey, I'm just saying from my own personal relationship with him, when I work with him, and we had our disagreements. I disagreed a lot of things that he did. But at the end of the day, you can always talk to him and hash things out.
All right. Before I let you go, what is your general sense of how Jalen is playing, how he's fitting in with the Dallas Mavericks, sitting back and watching that unfold?
I really believe he got drafted by the perfect team. They're going to play small. They're going to play a lot of players. They're going to play a lot of guards. So from that aspect, I think he got a great opportunity. I think he's getting an opportunity to play, right? And like we talk after every game, and he's playing great basketball. What he's not doing, what I thought he would struggle with defensively, he's playing great. What I thought he does best, he's not doing well, and that's making shots. So like I told him, I said, you got to calm your nerves and you got to learn, you got to make shots. You're only getting 3 to 5 shots a game.
Yeah.
You got to make them. That's the reality. If you make shots, you'll play more and you have a long career. If you don't make shots, no one wants an excuse. Well, I'm not getting the minutes. I'm not getting the shots. You'd be out the league. It's as simple as that.
Is there a trick to, because I believe that it's undervalued, the challenge of only getting 3-5 shots a game and being efficient and being aggressive in finding those 3-5 shots. You know, not assuming you're not a scorer, you're not a shooter, so in your role, you know, it's other guys are going to get it done. Is there a trick to maintaining that aggressiveness in those limited roles?
Yeah, there is a trick. The trick is when you're sitting on the bench, like I played with Steve Kerr toward the end of his career, and Steve was that guy. And I've never seen a guy won't play for 2 hours, come in and hit three in a row. Because he's watching the game saying, okay, if I come in, I'm getting that shot right there. Okay, that guy likes to cheat. I'm a backdoor. Like, he will, you can see that, you know, and I would tell Jalen the same thing. And the good thing about Jalen is he played three roles in college. People don't forget that. His freshman year, he played a two guard because Archie Diacono was a point. He got 5 shots a game. Same thing. His sophomore year, he played Robin to Batman, which is Josh Hart. So he understood that role. Then the senior year, he was Batman. So the guy knows how to play roles. It's just a matter of staying confident. And my job as a father and as a parent, as a coach, is to keep him confident. Yo, just don't take bad shots. Yeah. Take good shots, and you'll be fine. Because he can make shots. I mean, the guy can shoot.
That's really good stuff. Rick, as always, a pleasure, my friend. It was good to see you when we ran into each other in Phoenix. I'm really happy for you. I can't imagine being a dad, doing what you did, and then seeing your son come up, have the success that he's had, be able to participate in that. It almost feels like you get to have a second career in a way, right? You get to live this NBA experience.
It does, man. It's amazing to watch your kid. It's unbelievable. Like, I get excited on game day to watch him. It's just to watch.
No doubt. That is.
I appreciate it, Rick.
You got it, Rick. I appreciate it, and we'll do it again sometime. Thank you.
All right, boss. Take care.
Okay, you got it. All right, that concludes another edition of Bucher and Friends. Don't forget, you can follow the show on Twitter and Instagram at Bucher Friends. Drop us a rating and review on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. Screenshot the review and tweet it to us at Bucher Friends, and you'll be entered for a chance to win some swag. Also, check out our Twitter account for the link to our design contest at 99designs.com to submit concepts for our new cover art. Yes, it is a cash award. Submissions end on November 1st. In our next episode, Ryan Hollins, former NBA center, will be joining me, and we will discuss the topics of the day, including the tilt between the Utah Jazz and the Minnesota Timberwolves, what we see from those two teams early on. Is it possible that Jimmy Butler could actually stay in Minnesota and they could compete this year? And the Pelicans facing the Golden State Warriors. Are the Pelicans for real? I have my doubts, but we'll discuss. Thanks for listening.